Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Q1 FY22 earnings conference call of Quess Crop Limited, hosted by ICICI Securities. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Sudhir Kantipali from ICICI Securities. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thanks, Rituja. On behalf of ICICI Securities, I would like to thank the management team of Quess Corp for giving us the opportunity to host Q1 FY22 earnings call. We have with us Mr. Suraj Maraje, Managing Director, Mr. Ravi Vishwanath, CFO, Mr. Guruprasad Srinivasan, COO, Mr. Shekhar Garisa, Chief of Emerging Businesses and Corporate Development, Mr. Lohit Bhatia, President, Workforce Management, and Mr. Pinaki Kar, President, Global Technology Solutions, on the call. We will start with opening remarks from the management on Q1 FY22 performance and then open up the floor for questions. I will now hand over the proceedings to Girish for safe harbor statement. Thank you, and over to you, Girish.
Thanks, Sudhir. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining our earnings calls today. Please note that results and presentations are already uploaded on our website. Anything we say which refers to our outlook for the future is a forward-looking statement, and that must be read in conjunction with the risks that the company faces. These uncertainties and risks are included, but not limited to, what we have already mentioned in the prospectus filed with SEBI. With that said, I will now turn over the call to our Managing Director and Group CEO, Mr. Suraj Maraje. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sudhir. Thank you, Girish. And thank you all for joining us today. We hope you and your families are keeping safe as the economy opens up. We hope that you're vaccinated and that you're safely returning to your offices. Let me start by briefly giving you an update of the business and then hand over to Ravi to talk to the financials and also update you on the recent survey conducted by the IT department, which I'm sure is on your mind. We will then be happy to take any questions. Q1 saw our business once again weather a lockdown. This time around, we were better prepared. Our first focus for the quarter was to ensure the safety of our employees and their families, given that this wave was more personal for most of us. I'm happy to report that around 65% of our frontline workers have been vaccinated at least once. We've gotten full support from our customers in taking care of our people, and the response to the second wave was far more calibrated than observed during the first wave. As a result, the impact of the second wave on our business has been significantly less than the first wave of Q1 FY21, with several businesses continuing to grow in this time, as I'm sure you've noticed in our presentation. The recent wave did, of course, have some adverse effects on our business. As expected, our DigiCare services installation business and our Excellus training and skill development business were unable to operate during parts of the quarter due to lockdown. Sales momentum, as reflected in headcount growth, slowed a bit in the quarter. And in this context, the profit growth compensated for less of our salary increments than we'd hoped, which is why you see a marginal increase in our SG&A as a percent of revenue. However, I must say our sustained focus on execution did show through. Compared to a 20% QOQ decline in revenues in Q1 21, the last quarter saw our revenues stay flat versus Q4, indeed growing 24% year-on-year. While Q1 21 saw our headcount drop by 13% quarter-on-quarter, the last quarter saw our headcount grow by 1.5% quarter-on-quarter, up 10% year-on-year. We are happy to report that our OCF to EBITDA also remains strong at 75% and that we continue to build a formidable revenue pipeline for the coming quarter, acquiring 264 new customers in Q1 versus about 142 in Q4 21 and 196 a year ago. Moving on to specifics, let me start with the WFM platform as always, which posted a 17% EBITDA growth year on year. The general staffing headcount grew 1% Q1Q even through the lockdown and has grown 15% YOY, benefiting from our stem pre-wave 2. We've added 48 new customers in the quarter, and the growth pipeline for Q2 is very healthy at this point. Our focus on value-added services in GS is paying off. VAS has grown about 60% year-on-year, VAS being value-added services. We continue to increase tech adoption in our operations. For example, around 15% of GS recruitment today is now being done through QJobs, even though QJobs is currently present in only 4 cities, which account for 50% of our hiring volume. We've also launched specific initiatives and investments in construction, healthcare, and manufacturing, all three being sectors where we expect strong medium to long-term momentum. Our investee company, Taskmore, continues to execute at pace, although they too saw a temporary disruption to field activities during the lockdown. We're very excited by Taskmore's capabilities, which allow our general staffing business to expand its repertoire of SKUs from person months to person days and even person tasks. I'd like to say a big congratulations to the Taskmore team on being selected amongst Business World's top 30 technology disruptors. We must say we agree. The domestic IT staffing business continues to be in a demand-rich environment and has further grown its revenues during the quarter with a continued focus on higher margin business. We believe this business will continue to be resilient to COVID and will continue to raise its margins over time. At this moment, really, the focus is on ramping up our delivery capabilities, leveraging technology assets in sourcing, screening, onboarding, and deploying candidates. You would have seen that SG&A has gone up in this business marginally over the last quarter, and that's really because the higher skilled resources that we are hiring do require a higher recruiter intensity, and that's what's coming through in our cost. Outside of India, while the Middle East business continues to see good growth, our APAC business is witnessing headwinds given the sustained isolation of the Singapore economy and intermittent lockdowns in Malaysia and the Philippines. We will continue to take a through-cycle mindset to these businesses, driving sales and synergies across the region. The last part of our workforce management platform, our training and skill development business, saw some shutdowns in Q1. We do stay committed to running off the high fixed cost B2G business, driving collections and further optimizing productivity, even while we explore new B2B business models. Before moving on from WFM, we're pleased to let you know that we have formed a partnership with XLRI Jamshedpur to upskill the next generation of recruiters. We're delighted to play a role in partnering with India's premier education institution in the space to drive forward this critical profession, especially at a time when recruiting is becoming such a bottleneck in our country. So that was the FMS platform. Let me move on to our GTS platform, which has 4 service components. First, platform-based services. There are two platforms to which we offer these services, the HRO platform in our Indian subsidiary, Allsec, and the InsurTech platform in our MFX subsidiary in the US. The HRO platform delivered by Allsec saw the number of payslips processed per quarter grow 31% year-on-year. Note that this growth was without the 6-7% same customer growth that comes in a typical year. So we're delighted by the pace of customer acquisition and ramp up there. Our InsurTech business also has seen top line growth of 6% quarter on quarter in Q1, with 6 clients having gone live in the quarter. We are doubling down on our capabilities to drive these platform-based services, and you should see continued acceleration going forward. Second, on CLM, this is a business which has just delivered a 38% year-on-year top-line growth. 80% of this business is with domestic customers, mainly delivered by Connect, which had, by the way, its best quarter one ever. And the rest of it is for the North American customers, delivered mainly by Allsec. Within CLM, the voice-based CLM has proved remarkably resilient to the second wave, as it grew by about 6% quarter-on-quarter, 54% year-on-year. This really shows the untapped potential in India for voice-based services and for better customer services. We also believe this represents a higher shift towards virtual customer service due to the pandemic and due to pressures to improve customer service while sustaining costs. A key focus of the CLM business has been to expand beyond voice, and the non-voice CLM revenue has grown by about 15% year-on-year. Our teams are working hard to convert more of our CLM customers to omni-channel users via our unique CLM-in-a-box digital solutions. The third part of GTS is our non-voice BPO business. This is largely done at Connect with a focus on collections. which we are also currently in the process of platformizing. We are actually India's largest professionally run collections company. The collections business was severely impacted actually in this lockdown, with a 13% reduction in top line versus the quarter below, albeit still growing 29% year on year. The domestic F&A business has seen a 23% year on year top line growth, and we continue to aggressively explore new deals in this growth segment. The fourth part of our GTS platform is our IT services. We offer IT services both in India and Canada. Our domestic IT services business saw revenue up 49% year on year and 7% quarter on quarter, with four new customer acquisitions in the quarter. We have observed a real paucity of quality players in the Indian domestic space, and we will continue to build our presence here, adding new competencies to our existing infrastructure management services and cybersecurity. In the US, our IT services business actually grew 27% year on year. The Canada business is also seeing growth, although a bit slower at 11% year on year, and we're seeing how we can invest further to accelerate this growth. Being in the people business, we take people matters seriously, and in this regard, we are grateful that even while Quest Corp has overall been voted a great place to work, our subsidiary in Canada has been voted amongst Canada's 50 greatest places to work. And our Connect subsidiary has been bestowed two awards in the last two quarters. Number one, it's number 92 among Great Places to Work, India's best companies to work for 2021. And it's in CII's National HR Excellence Award as well. So that was GTS. Next, moving on to the OEM platform. Of all of our businesses, I would say that the facilities and security service business has been most impacted by the pandemic, given that ITES and education sectors accounted for 49% of our pre-COVID revenues, and these sectors are yet to return to their workplace. While Q4 has seen some limited upside in these sectors, Q1 again saw demand reduction at existing customers and delays in transitions at new clients. Despite this, our ISM business has seen revenues up 4% quarter on quarter, 5% year on year, driven by some very aggressive customer acquisitions in the past quarters. New customer acquisitions continue to remain healthy, about 53 in the last quarter versus 26 in the same quarter last year. The pest and disinfection business also is up in terms of revenue 68% year on year. Our security business has not fared as well in the second wave, with Q1 seeing a slide versus the recovery made in Q3 and Q4. The revenues were down 3%. With the main reductions being in retail and infrastructure verticals, where some customers have once again downsized requirements. Again, here, customer acquisition momentum remains strong. We strongly believe that the IFM and security businesses have the potential to grow at least 20% year on year, and we will take a through cycle view to these businesses. We hope that as towards the end of the year, businesses return to work from the offices, we will start to see a strong recovery here. The industrial business continues to see momentum, strong momentum, with revenues up 31% year on year as the market shifts from local contractors to O&M experts. We won five new clients in the quarter. We also mobilized manpower for our first win in fertilizer industry, and we commenced a metering project in Haryana that added about 1.2 million meters to our portfolio. I'm also happy to say that we've completed the innovation of the Ahmedabad Smart City project, allowing faster project execution and better collections. Let me move to our emerging businesses. Monster continues to execute promisingly. Both revenue and new customer sales showed a positive trend quarter on quarter, despite periods of non-operation in sales due to lockdown and a lower renewal base as typical of Q1 versus Q4. Sales grew by 69% year on year, although admittedly off a smaller base in Q1 last year. Across the board, Monster's product performance metrics continue to improve as we implement our transition towards being India's leading talent ecosystem. Q1 saw further growth in operational metrics like candidate acquisition and job postings, which you'll see in our presentation. Key customer satisfaction metrics like retention rate and average order size have also witnessed an upward trend quarter and quarter. I'm also happy to report we've made significant strides in Southeast Asia, with new business growing 17% quarter on quarter and 128% year on year. QJobs also continued its march towards being India's most efficient platform for recruiters and job seekers in the grey collar space. With new candidate registrations up 81% quarter on quarter, third party users up 53% quarter on quarter, and active job openings up 65% quarter on quarter across four cities, both recruiters and seekers at this point are raving about the app's unique ability to credentialize talent and match it with opportunities. In fact, our third-party customers give us an NPS score of 50%, and it's actually still growing. Finally, our after-sales and installation business, DigiCare, saw losses in Q1 again due to lockdown, although volumes have now rapidly recovered. We will continue to remain focused on service excellence in DigiCare and on building a D2C business for products and services through extended warranty and beyond. So that was a view of our platforms. On the operational side, we remain watchful of cost and collections. Even as we launch new initiatives to drive recruiter productivity, further digitize and optimize our internal operating structures. I'm happy to say that our new S4 implementation is live and we're working now on progressively improving its effectiveness. Further, across our businesses, we continue to focus on digitizing how we manage our associates, including through digital training, digital workflow management, and digital HR. We are also continuing focus on cross-sell with a set of new programs and internal targets. In fact, Q1 saw 24 wins with an ACV of about 75 crores versus about 270 crores of ACV from cross-sell all of last year. As India unlocks, we are more focused than ever on the growth opportunities ahead of us. With our unmatched breadth of service capabilities, technology assets, and talent, we are distinctly positioned to benefit from the growth to come. And we'd like to re-emphasize our determination to achieve our twin goals of 20% ROE and 20% OCF CAGR by FY23. We thank you, the analysts and the investor community, for your support to us and to our institution. And with this, let me hand over to Ravi. Over to you, Ravi.
Thank you, Suraj. Good morning, everybody. I hope all of you are doing well and have been vaccinated too. Let me talk about the overall performance first. A quick walkthrough of financial performance of the company will show that our overall revenues in Q1 remained flat as compared to the immediate previous quarter, and we grew about 24% on a year-on-year basis. All segments of our business posted healthy growth numbers, with workforce management, technology solutions, and operating asset management platforms grew by 24%, 22%, and 26% respectively on a year-on-year basis. Consequently, EBITDA in Q1 22 improved by 13% on a year-on-year basis to 147 crores against 130 crores in Q1 of FY21. However, normalized EBITDA declined by 6% on a quarter-on-quarter basis due to seasonality factor in some businesses such as Connect and the second wave of COVID pandemic. Segment-wise, our staffing on workforce management, our staffing business continues to grow by over 20% on a year-on-year basis. Professional staffing business also performed exceptionally well, growing by 15% quarter-on-quarter. Training and skill development businesses continue to remain subdued due to centers being shut down during the second wave. Global technology solutions continue to perform well in Q1, with Connect achieving the highest ever quarter one revenue and EBITDA this quarter on the back of growing CLM business. Collection business took a hit during the lockdown, yet was able to grow substantially on an annual basis. Monster saw a slight negative EBITDA on account of increased investment in the product and the second wave of the pandemic. Operating asset management. The facility management business grew 5% year-on-year. Top line remained flat on a quarter-on-quarter basis. Both facility management and security businesses continue to see the headwinds as IT and ITES companies and education facilities remain closed in quarter one. SG&A costs overall saw a marginal uptick due to increase in salary costs. Monthly SG&A recurring cost for Q1 was 56 crores, as against 51 crores in Q4 of FY21. We expect SG&A costs to normalize at these levels. However, while we continue to focus on trying to reduce these costs further, a clearer picture would emerge once offices reopen and people get back to offices. The reported PAT in Q1 22 is 45 crores, an increase of 22% year-on-year basis. I'd like to take a moment to talk about the recent tax survey and the reduction under Section 80JJAA of the Income Tax Act. The Income Tax Department conducted a survey at the Registered Office of Quest and that of Terrier Security Services on the 8th, 9th and 10th of July 2021. We extended full cooperation to the department, including providing complete information in a timely manner, and have not received any claims to date. We have been very conservative in our accounting of Section 80JJAA benefit. We have not claimed the benefits for eligible candidates who have completed 240 days with the organization but were not on our payrolls as of 31st of March in a given year. The income concealment of 880 crores, as mentioned in the press release, is higher than the overall PAT during these years under survey, and we still do not have a clear picture as to how these numbers have been arrived at. We have taken advice from eminent experts and are fully confident of the position that we have adopted in our claim. Balance sheet related updates. Focusing on the balance sheet, due to the purchase of the remaining 30% in Connect for 208 crores and the dividend payout, we currently have a net debt of 151 crores on the balance sheet as against a net cash position of 99 crores in Q4 21. However, as stressed during our previous calls, we assure you that we will bring the gross debt down to our net cash position over the next couple of quarters. Our continued focus on cash conversion has seen Q1 22 delivering an OCF to EBITDA conversion of 75% against 93% in Q4 21. This is important because this reflects true business performance. On the corporate structure front, we continue to simplify our organizational structure. The board has given the approval to amalgamate three wholly owned subsidiaries, namely MFX, Greenpeace, and Connect, and that process is currently underway. We will continue on simplification of the organization structure through the year. We also increased our stake in Task Mode to 33%, the second investment of 3.2 crores during July. Once again, we would like to thank you for your continued support during these unprecedented times, and I would like to now open the floor for questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Sudhir Kantapali from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, Siraj, my first question is to you on AllSec Technologies. So it has been quite some time since we acquired this entity. Any thoughts on a potential merger or amalgamation with Quest going forward?
Thanks, Sudhir. I think the answer is there are no updates right now. Look, I think these are both listed companies, and so merging them is, I think there's a complexity around it, and there's a SEBI requirement around it in terms of process. At this point, we're not seeing a pressing need to execute such a merger, Sudhir. I think that, you know, both companies are executing well individually. We're extracting whatever synergies we need to. And the reality is, if we were to go ahead with a merger, it would have to be after taking both the Quest and AllSec shareholder interest into account. We've got to make sure it makes sense for both of them, including our own goal of a 20% ROE. So, you know, it's not that we've ruled it out. We're looking at it, but I think at this point, we're not seeing a pressing need. There obviously is cash at AllSec, and we've, you know, the board there has now put in place a dividend policy. So we have to see sort of what dividends play out there as well, and when and how, but really no updates on a merger today.
Sure, Siraj. And Ravi, on the query raised by the Income Tax Department, since it has been a month and no claim or update was received from them so far, Is it fair to assume that they are satisfied with your response or with your interpretation of Section 80JJAA and this issue is completely behind?
I would not like to think so. I would think that they are actually working behind, I mean, they're probably currently working. And I do think that we will hear back from them on this particular matter within the next 30 to 45 days is what we believe. So this is actually more of an industry issue, Sudhir. I don't think this issue can be isolated to Quess, because I'm sure most companies in the industry would have followed a similar kind of method in arriving at the claim. So this is something that we will, as an industry, have to face this. And I don't think the issue is behind us yet. We will wait to hear from them, but we have done our homework in terms of what the back-end analysis and calculations, and do believe that we are ready with any with answers should they come back with whatever questions that they have.
Sure, Ravi. And just one follow-up. Is there any precedent that you would have done due diligence on of, let's say, some company where this issue would have arisen and let's say it was sorted out either in court or out of court?
Of the three matters that the income tax issue raised for 80JJAA, let me quickly just talk about it. One is on the determination of average of salary below 25,000 rupees per month. The second is to consider reimbursement as part of salary. And the third one, which is the employee to be on the payroll of the company for the succeeding 2 years. We do have judicial pronouncements for two out of the three, which is reimbursements and the employee having to continue on our roles in the subsequent 2 years. There are judicial precedents available, and both of the jurisdictional high court and jurisdictional tribunal, while we do not have a judicial precedent for the first one.
Sir Ravi, and on the outcome, is it in favor of the company or how exactly was the precedent?
Yes, both the decisions are in favor of the SEC, of the taxpayer.
Got it, Ravi. And one last question from my side, maybe Guru or Lohit can answer. Actually, we are seeing a very strong pickup in hiring across both white-collar space and across blue-collar space in the industry. And this is a broad-based phenomena across sectors. Let's say maybe some of the sectors like e-commerce, BFSI, we are seeing a very strong pickup. And in a few other sectors also, we are seeing if not very strong, maybe a strong pickup. And some of your competitors, if I look at their commentary, it has been very upbeat in this quarter. But your commentary seems to be a little more calibrated and balanced at this juncture. Should we read it as a bit of an extra caution, or should we read it as, you know, any other potential headwind that you might be looking at this juncture?
First and foremost, Sudhir, fact is true that, you know, we are also talking about open mandates coming in, and it's, those discussions are definitely happening in logistic and supply chain space, which is the most sought these days. So, definitely they are coming in. But there's some wait and watch on the third wave around here. So, either the hirings are getting slightly deferred that's what we are currently experiencing. But coming specific back to the white-collar segment, you can see how the technology staffing is doing, and that space is really doing well. And it's quite visible on our results. So, I would say there's little wait and watch for the logistic and supply chain.
So maybe just a couple of things that I want to add. I think that at this point, if you look at the current pace of recovery, the current trajectory, I think we're headed towards our best, as an economy, our best Q3 ever. Let's be very clear about that. I think the calibrated response is just that, we all saw the best Q4 ever also. I think we just don't, the shape and form of COVID is just an unknown to us, right? So, that is where we're getting calibrated. But I think, are we seeing the opening of mandates now? Are we seeing the momentum? The answer is absolutely. And on the IT side, for example, we've had headcount grow significantly in the quarter, plus we've had higher value headcount. So all of that is happening. I think the reality is most of corporate India, as we see it, is keeping one eye on the timing, depth and synchronicity of wave three. I think the hope is that even if it comes, it's not going to be synchronous across states, and therefore we'll, as an economy, be able to weather it better. But I think one can't ignore the presence of COVID at this point, Sudhir. I don't think that would be prudent at all.
Got it, Siraj. Thanks. I'll join back in the queue.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Mukul Garg from Motilal Oswal. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks. I have one for Suraj and Ravi. Suraj, on the GTS side, this quarter was flat on the top line side. There was a very marginal growth while your domestic IT services business grew quite smartly. You highlighted Connect, but was there a bit of a softness on a QQ basis in the international business as well? And what was the reason behind that?
Sure. So I think the international business in GTS is doing just fine, right? As I mentioned in WFM, WFM does have an international business around APAC and Singapore. I think there, the impact of COVID has actually been in a sense higher now than it was a year ago, right? But GTS, no. I think the two impacts on GTS, Mukul. One is just the collections, right, which is a fair part of what we do at Connect, like I mentioned. The field activity was locked for a couple of months, and usually Q4 is anyway far better than Q1 because there's a strong push by the banks to collect as many NPAs as they can before the end of the year, right? So Q1, there is seasonality there, and then there is a lockdown effect on collection. Two, Q4 is always an extraordinary quarter for the HRO business in AllSec, because we do the Form 16A processing, which brings sort of, you know, which is a highly profitable and an incremental business there. So those are the two things I would say from a business perspective. If you're looking at the segment reporting on the last page, where we have GTS and emerging businesses, then I would add from an EBITDA perspective, two additional impacts, Mukul. One will be our DigiCare business, which was locked down for parts, and that is in the back page segment reporting as part of GTS. And the second is Monster went through a cloud migration in the quarter. So we had double burn on cloud for parts of the quarter. So the Monster burn was about 2.5 crores higher than a quarter before. That should come down over the next coming quarters.
Sure. And Ravi, on the margin side, if you take out the provision reversal this quarter, you guys had a fairly sharp dip in margins at 4.4. If you can just help us through a margin walk of the pulls and pushes there, and how should we see profitability over the near to medium term, as you mentioned that SG&A will normalize at the elevated level. So if you can just help us, how should we think about the margins going forward?
So I would say that these probably are the lowest margins that will probably come at for the current year, barring unforeseen circumstances. This you could take these as a baseline margin for the year. We have been impacted, like I said, the Connect business. In fact, we've had the impact of the Connect business. We've had the impact of Excellus. We've had impact on costs, which is actually the payroll is the kind of cost increases. We've had DigiCare, which has been shut, which actually contributed to almost about 4.5 crores in losses for the current quarter. And of course, Suraj alluded to the extra cost in Monster that we had to bear. So overall, I think but for these one-off items, our margins would have certainly been much higher. And like I said, these would be the lowest that we can probably think of for the year. It can only get better from here, Mukul.
So, sorry, just to follow up on this, what would be the impact of the one-offs in the quarter on margin? And, if you take out the wage hike and Monster losses, these issues would have been there a year ago as well, whereas your margins are down almost 100 basis points from, the same quarter last year. So, that way, is there some incremental cost pressure coming on the wage side, which is leading to lower profitability?
Not really, because the Monster was actually positive, has actually been up in Q1 21, as opposed to Q1 22. Monster was actually up in Q1 21, and we also remember that we had salary cuts in Q1 of last year versus an increment in the current year. Not just the extra cost, but we had increased salary costs compared to Q4 itself. So I think the year-on-year comparison probably is not right. I'd be happy to walk you these things a little more in detail, but it is largely on account of Excellence, DigiCare, Monster in the current quarter, and the Connect business, me slightly dipping on the collections part for Q1.
And you could also remember Q1 last year, we didn't give increments, which we have given this year.
Yes, salary cuts as well.
Yeah. There is a difference there. The other thing I would say on Monster, because you'll recall Q1 last year was a very low quarter from a sales perspective. Given this is a SaaS business, you'll see a bit of a lag effect of that also, right? So on Monster specifically, the increase in sales we're seeing now will actually hit the bottom line in the coming quarters. There's always a lag there.
Fair enough. Thanks for answering my question. I'll get back into the queue.
Sorry, Mukul, there is one more point that I do want to make, which if you take last quarter versus this quarter and you look at WFM, if you take this quarter last year, a lot of the bonuses and incentives to associates were absolutely cut to the bone, right? People did not pay. Whereas, like I've alluded, this time I think the humanitarian response was just better. For us, those bonuses and incentives often tend to be passed through, so they increase the top line, bottom line, and that also then effectively sort of moderates the margin of the GS business without a reduction in the pricing per se, right? So you will see that the top line of GS has gone up quarter on quarter substantially.
So Suraj, just on this, can you quantify what would have been the margin impact from all of these?
So the bonus pass through that was there in this quarter versus a year ago was about 120 crores of top line.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks for answering the question.
Thanks.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants to ask a question, please press star and one. The next question is from the line of Jonas Buda from PhillipCapital. Please go ahead.
Hi, gentlemen, and congratulations on a decent set of numbers despite the challenges. A couple of questions, sir. Firstly, more bookkeeping kind of question there. If Ravi can explain why the tax rate, particularly in the subsidiaries, as in when net of console minus standalone, seems so abnormally high. At about 28 odd crores. That's the first one. Then I'll follow it up with the other two.
Yeah. When we declared a dividend from Allsec Manila into Allsec India, there was a dividend distribution tax of 16 crores that we had to incur. So this tax has been considered as current tax in the quarterly reporting. The benefit of this tax is available to be set off against the income that we earn during the year. So this is really a one-time tax cost that we've actually incurred in Q1. And actually Allsec moves to a 25% tax because they were under MAT until last year. They will move into a 25% tax rate for the current year. And so we will get the benefit of this over the year. So that is what has actually spiked the current tax rates to higher than what we would normally see, actually, Jonas.
So what would your, full year tax assumption be, as in tax rate assumption be for the Quess consolidated entity, sir, for, keeping in mind this Q1 impact?
Yes. Overall, I think for the year, we will probably come in at about 17-18% of effective tax rate as a company for the year.
Understood. The second question was where you sort of touched upon, how you see the margin trajectory progressively on both GTS and WFM. Wanted to pick your brain on OAN because that business at least has shown a multi-quarter high kind of margin. Is there some one-off embedded within that, or is this now back to the normal margin kind of scenario that we should build in for the remainder of the year?
I think 7% would be anything between 7-7.2% would be more or less like steady state margins in the operating asset management business. There are some one-time some collections that have been embedded in the current quarter, but by and large, I think 7% would be a steady state margin in the operating asset management. And we have actually done some back-end improvements in the as far as the facility management business is concerned, the benefits of all of those should start playing out once offices reopen and people get back to offices. We should probably start seeing better productivity of our people when offices reopen in the facility management business.
Understood. And last one, if I can quickly squeeze in. So basically, for WFM, should we at least assume that you get to what you did in FY21? Because, you know, you are at 3.5, while, you know, Suraj highlighted that there was a 120 crore, you know, impact of the bonus increment that actually didn't flow down to the EBITDA. But at least, 3.7, which you did for the full year FY21, is something that we should build in?
Absolutely, without a doubt, yeah.
Understood. Got it. Thank you, and I'll come back in the queue.
Sure.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vidit Shah from IIFL Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi. Good morning, and thanks for taking my question. Just to clarify the point that you made on the increased tax rate due to dividend distribution in AllSec from Philippines to India, are you saying that this tax will be set off against any tax liability that AllSec has going forward, or how does this work?
You're right. India has a tax treaty with Philippines, and this tax would be available as a set off under the double tax avoidance agreement.
Okay, so has this not been set off this quarter itself, or it's set off
You will have to compute it for the whole year, and then do the set off with it.
All right, understood. And secondly, just trying to understand the training and skill development business. The revenues have been kind of flat year on year, quarter on quarter. Sorry. What is the level of operations, capacity operations that, you know, the business is operating at currently, and, you know, where can these revenues go when, you know, they operate at full capacity?
See, we were operating at about 50% capacity in Q4. That was when we had opened up some of our centers. You know, I mean, we operate about 120 centers across 20 states where we conduct these training programs. And we were operating at about 50% capacity in Q4. And at full capacity, our revenue would be in the range of about 50 to 60 crores a year. And currently, again, in Q1, we've seen we are operating at about maybe less sub 5% currently, So we do expect that these will start reopening over time. And by about Q3, we expect, you know, if the third wave is not very severe, we do expect to get back to at least about 70-75% of the centers being open by Q4.
All right, and that would drive a significant margin improvement within the WFM side.
That's right, yeah.
All right. Also, just one last clarification on the provisions that you made last quarter for the Exelis and the Timex business. Is there any update on, you know, if anything's been received? Have you reversed any of these things?
So, as far as Timex is concerned, we've had the contract novated. We discussed when the government came forward, while we had made a provision on one side, we discussed internally, when the government came back to us with their proposal to novate the contract on some new terms, we discussed whether we should at all go ahead or should we just back off from the project. But then we took a call in the larger interest of the business. We took a call that it would be in our best interest, especially after having come thus far. We said, let's go ahead, have the contract completed, and try and collect as much money as possible. And in the current month, we have recovered about 23 crores out of the past dues on GST from the government. Nothing much as far as TSE is concerned, but this is the update as far as Climax.
All right, fine.
We do expect to receive some more over the next few months, over the next few weeks or months, Jonas. Yeah.
All right. Fine, that's helpful. I'll get back in queue for more. Thanks.
Thank you, Vidit.
Thank you. Participants, to ask a question, please press star and one now. The next question is from the line of Raghuram NS from All India Funds Management. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Hi, Raghuram. We can hear you.
Yeah, I just wanted to, I have been an investor in AllSec and have always been tracking how Quess has been managing the investment. This was regarding the obviously the comment made by Mr. Ajit Isaac during the AGM of AllSec, when it was very clearly mentioned that a merger with Connect or with Quess itself would be considered and taken at the right time. I obviously heard your first comment to the first question that was made, that both companies seem to be going along at their own pace, and there doesn't seem to be a need to immediately do anything about it. But it always was something that we at AllSec, the investors who remained, were obviously wanting some clarity on what was the thinking behind continuing these two companies as separate. Now Connect has also been obviously merged into the main company, but this remains as a separate entity, whereas there is no clarity on how the process would evolve over the next few quarters itself. So if you can please clarify as to whether there is a decision going to be taken at all, or is it just going to be continuing like this for a long period of time?
Sure, Raghuram. Thank you for your question. And look, I mean, I absolutely appreciate where you're coming from on this. I think the reality is this is a rapidly evolving business environment. And at the end of the day, we're also getting to understand AllSec's capabilities better. It's not that we're not looking at it. We're still looking at it. You would have seen that we have move to merge Connect into Quess. So we're doing the right things at the right time. You just said at this point, we're not seeing a need to do this. Also, you'd have seen as an AllSec investor, the performance has gone up. I think Quess is doing whatever we can to use our global tech solutions platform to open doors for AllSec, improve the pace of customer acquisitions. In India also, our general staffing business is introducing them to help them cross-sell to general staffing customers. So a lot of those issues are being worked through anyway, operationally. As far as a merger goes, I think there's many considerations in the mix here, and we're working through all those considerations to figure out, given they're both publicly listed companies, what is the right thing going forward. It will evolve when we're looking at it, but I just can't give you, I'm sure you'll appreciate, I can't make a specific comment on this at this point.
Yeah, I understand. I obviously appreciate the fact that both these are listed companies, so there are very clearly processes and sensitivities that need to be handled here. But it would always be much more helpful for shareholders saying that, okay, unless these conditions are met, we will continue as separate companies. Or we just have some kind of a plan to put something together over the next 6 months. Because of the fact that there is no real timeline to any decision.
Yeah, no, I hear you. Unfortunately, with two public listed companies, it's impractical, possibly illegal to put a timeline in place, Raghuram. But I hear you, and let's take this. We'll take this as a point, and we'll chew on this one.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you for your comment.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, this was the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Suraj Miraji for closing comments.
Sure. I just want to start again by thanking ICICI Securities and Sudhir for hosting the call. Really appreciate it. We want to thank all of you for being here today. Q1 was a tough environment. We're very pleased with how the business has, while still focusing on the humanitarian side, weathered through it. 24% revenue growth, 22% PAT growth, staying flat quarter on quarter, increasing headcount. We're looking forward to the quarters to come. I think there is very strong momentum in the businesses.
We are committed to executing, very focused on that, and I hope you see the resolve and the purpose coming through on these calls. We're continuing to invest in our sales delivery capabilities. We believe the Quest platform is getting more and more differentiated over time from our competitors, driving our cross-sell and driving our demand. Our tech assets are doing very well, Monster, QJobs, and others. So outlook, I think overall the outlook is positive. I'd like to say thank you again, and we look forward to speaking to you again in a quarter. In the meantime, stay safe, and please, if you're not vaccinated, get vaccinated. And most importantly, go back to your offices. It's good for you, it's good for us. Thanks very much.
Thank you. On behalf of ICICI Securities, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your line.